Hello everybody, and welcome to the final episode of the Young Man's Adventures here on BallinCraig Estate. It's been almost a year and a half on the YouTube channel here. The episodes have not always been super frequent, but it's certainly been a bit of a story. Now, the observant of you might already have noticed that we're in winter, so some time has passed since the last episode. And you might also notice something looks slightly different over here. So, we'll walk with the young man. It's a quiet morning here on the farm. In the last episode, the young man got a lot of help from his friends to bring in the silage. And on top of that, Henry and Thomas, two nearby farmers, helped him out tremendously by basically selling silage for him on his behalf and giving him the money. And that meant that the young man could afford to replace the building that had fallen over in a storm back here on the farm. He even had money over for a small shed here, a new fence up for the sheep, and there's now a bit of extra room to park tractors in here, which is brilliant. They deserve a bit of cover, he feels. So, from that perspective, things have gone the right way since our last episode. That help from his friends really made a huge difference. This morning he's out, he's tending to the cows. Since the last episode, a couple of months have passed, and we're getting up towards the time where the Passover is happening. Unfortunately, at the lawyer's company, which we found out was basically represented by Chancellor Chalmers' son, who's very interested in apparently buying a large chunk of land around here to try and turn it into either a golf club or country resort or something like that. They still haven't accepted this as an adequate replacement. And as a consequence of that, with some help again from Henry and Thomas and from Trevor, the young man's going to court. He's basically defending his claim that he has made a genuine replacement for the farm that's actually for the better. And as such, what was in his uncle's will of him running the farm for a year has been met. And he then qualifies to inherit the farm fully and in his own right. The Chancellor did offer to buy the farm off the young man for quite a handsome sum of money. And there are times when the young man thinks that it would have been nice, but he's gotten used to a farming life and he frankly does not want to see this farm getting turned into anything else. So, it is time to get the animals sorted out this morning. Trevor is probably at work. The young man has been taking over more and more of the animal tending duties. That was one of the things that Trevor mainly did for him. So the young man has spent the last couple of months getting to grips a lot more with the cattle, with Trevor's expert guidance, and he's also become much more familiar with the sheep, learning from Helen, who looks after them obviously, but he's been able to help out, and so he's become a lot more confident in running the farm. And of course, with Trevor away, Helen is back in the city. It turns out that in addition to her aunt and looking after sheep, she actually owned a flat in town and she's selling it. And this actually means that she's always talked about going away. finding a place where she could keep sheep and do some of her artwork and have a nice place in the countryside. This worries the young man a bit because they've obviously become quite romantically involved, and as things are going now with the upcoming battle in court, if everything goes to plan, then I mean, then BallinCraig is his home, and from that perspective, he's not quite sure where that leaves them. This has been resting on his mind quite a bit over the last couple of weeks in particular, because Helen has increasingly been in contact with her solicitors. Seems like she's actually found a buyer for her flat in the city, which of course means that certainly she will have the money to be able to start fulfilling that part of her dream. And the young man doesn't want to stand in the way of her dreams, but he also don't really want to lose her. So it's a little bit of a pickle in some ways. But the young man carries on cleaning up. It is time to get some straw, some silage, everything into the cows. The sheep, he thinks, are pretty okay as they are here. And there's still a decent amount in the trough. Obviously, we're into winter now, and the grass isn't growing much anymore, so they can still go out, but there isn't much for them to graze, so it really does require feed to come into the animals now. There's still a little bit of the old spring silage left here at the back, but it's going down fairly quickly. However, with the large stack of bales sitting in here, the young man has been doing the calculations, and there is absolutely no concern at all about the ability to feed the animals. In fact, it'll be comfortably into spring and summer before there's even the slightest bit of need. It might even stretch over into the following year. They had a good year, a very productive year when it comes to hay and silage. So from that perspective, he's feeling a lot more relaxed. He does still have £12,000 in his account after paying for the shed. Well, actually the two sheds that were constructed on the farm. They weren't big fancy ones, but he still feels that they're actually more functional and useful for the farm than what was there before. And that's why he did take the advice from Henry and Thomas to fight it. He's actually been in touch. It's Henry and Thomas's solicitor that is going to be representing him. And that's going to cost him between £6,000 and £8,000, so definitely half, possibly more, of all the money he's got left. But it'll take him back down to basically where he was at the beginning of the year, so from that perspective he doesn't consider it that big a deal. Right, time to park up this tractor here and get some straw laid in for the cows as well. So they're still using these hand bales that the young man created all by himself. Crazy hard work for a day over the top of the field there. But they're coming in handy. They do have larger straw bales sitting up in the shed up the road a bit. And he's wondering whether he should actually nip up, because the smaller bales here, they're quite handy to just sort of run across the road here for the cows, and that'll be handy during winter if they get any snow. So maybe we should head up with him and get that sorted. We'll just drop off this one hand bale in here and make a bit of bedding for a couple of the cows. There we go. So, young man's gonna head up. Doesn't really need any transport. He's just gonna put a single round bale onto the spikes, and traffic's not so bad around here that he can't get away with that. He would like to have one of those spikes that you actually put on the back of the tractor instead. That would be quite convenient for this kind of job. He keeps finding himself laying plans for the future of BallinCraig, but then stopping himself. He doesn't want to get ahead of himself until he knows what the outcome of this whole court thing is going to be. Doesn't take the young man too long to get one of the straw bales. He kind of has to roll them out from the side. That's the only thing that's a little bit awkward, because they are large and heavy, and some of them are stacked. But by the time he clears some of the first ones out, there'll be room to actually get the tractor in. But for now, this works okay. Just got to remember to close the door here as well. As you can see, there's plenty of supplies up here at this end of the farm as well. So with the straw dropped off for the cows, bedding is needed. It's below zero. It's freezing, particularly during the nights now. So the one thing the young man has really left to do this morning is to get some water in for both the cows and the sheep, and probably close these doors up again, because it's actually quite cold. Milking was already done this morning before we joined him. The milking robot is not the most high capacity, but it's, you know, it's a smaller farm, and it actually works quite well. They've been having a steady income, not fantastic. It almost just evens out with the running costs of the farm, really, when it comes down to it. But it's time to go and get the water trailer. The old Deutz is a pretty good little machine for moving around the yard and doing the water. Just as he's coming in with the trailer, one of the cows have decided to stop here, so he's just gotta gently shunt her out of the way. Come on now. Another one of his plans that he has been thinking about would be to eliminate this having to cart around a water trailer and actually get pipes laid in, perhaps both for sheep and cows, but he doesn't want to jump to conclusions. So he's kind of taken to interchanging, leaving the water trailer over the sheep and over here the cows. That seems to have worked out okay in general. The cows are looking good. There's not much grass left for them here, so he has started putting in hay for them as well. That's working out quite well. As soon as you can get past them, at least, he clambers over the fence. So Helen and Trevor are both gonna come with the young man. Well, actually, Helen is meeting him in the city where the courtroom is. And Trevor is gonna come back from work early so that they can get going. They have both been asked to testify in the case. It should be a one-day affair, he hopes. He really doesn't want to have to pay for hotels and everything in the city. He's not exactly made out of money once he's paid for the solicitor and everything like that. There's one other investment that he does want to make today, and that's because winter is closing in. His uncle did have an old snowplow once, because you do get snow here on BallinCraig Estate occasionally. Not hugely so, but it could be on the cards. And the old snowplow had actually rusted up. It had been sitting over in the back of the field, and it's yeah, there were holes in the blade. So the young man had spoken to Mike the mechanic and asked if there were any around. Mike has managed to source one at a very sensible and reasonable cost. So the young man is heading down to see Mike. They have grown a lot closer since Mike came and helped bring the silage in as well. And Mike has kind of accepted that, well, the young man and Helen is now a couple, and, well, Mike's chances of ever perhaps meeting and being together with Helen is sort of disappeared. And Mike has accepted that, and he now works quite happily with them as good friends. In fact, he seems to be having an warm eye towards one of the ladies from the bingo club that came and helped out as well. After a bit of a chat with Mike and getting the blade hooked on, the young man heads out. It's actually a pretty decent looking blade, and Mike sourced it to him for less than £1,000. It's an old one that's been used by the council, but it's perfectly adequate for whatever little, hopefully little, that the young man might need it for. But he likes the idea of being prepared, even if it might just be for the last few weeks of him living on BallinCraig. It might be a bit optimistic and jumping ahead of him to invest in a snowplow, but he feels that it's still a responsible thing to do. You never know. The young man puts the blade down right outside of the shed here, because that way, if it's ever needed, it's literally right next to the tractor, and it shouldn't be any problem in getting it out. So, time is up to about 10:40. He's got to get in and get himself a shower. Trevor's going to be back soon, and they need to be heading up because the court case starts at 2, and it's a couple of hours' drive. It's not too much later when Trevor comes walking up the lane. He's been dropped off by a co-worker. They finished up early today, which is good, because Trevor knows that it's a big day, not just for the young man, but basically for the future of BallinCraig Estate. The young man is standing looking up. "You're right, lad." The young man smiles at Trevor. "Yeah, I was just standing, you know, taking in the scenery, but I gotta get in the shower, and I guess I better get changed for the big day."
"Aye," says Trevor. "Yeah, I guess I better too. I'll hop in the shower too, and I'll see you out here in about 20 minutes.
"Yep, that sounds good. Trevor, I just want to say to you, no matter what happens in court, it's been a real pleasure working with you this year."
"Hey, laddie, save it for later. This is not over, and there'll be plenty of more working to do."
"I sure hope so," says the young man as he heads in to grab himself a shower. So here we are, a little while later, and the young man has a slightly unusual and uncomfortable feeling in this suit. But yeah, the solicitors were pretty clear. Dress up, look the part, look like you're serious about running this business. So there's not much for it, except get in the car together with Trevor and head off into the city. So together, Trevor and the young man sets off slowly, almost reluctantly, from BallinCraig Estate, as the fate, in many ways, are going to be decided at what comes next. They don't speak much on the journey into the city, because it's a tense moment for everybody. It is quite a lot later as the young man and Trevor are driving back once again in pretty much silence. Oh, says the young man, we should have had dinner at Sam's Fish and Chips instead of that petrol station.
Yeah, says Trevor. Well, lad, we'll have the chance again tomorrow.
Turns out that court cases, they take a long time. There's a lot of talk. There's a lot of technicalities that the young man did not understand a thing of. But most of the proceedings were done today, but it was too late in the day for the judge to fully consider the case and deliver a ruling. So they've been adjourned until tomorrow afternoon. So one more night of torturous waiting, but at least they're back on BallinCraig Estate. The young man gets inside the house, gets the suit off, and feels the frustration of the fact that there wasn't a decision today. It's incredibly annoying. A little while later, there's a knock on the door. It's Helen. How are you doing? She says. Well, you were there, he says. You know it's all a waiting game, and we're just going to have to see what happens tomorrow, aren't we? Well, that's actually what I came to talk to you about, says Helen. You know, I've sold my flat now, and you know how I talked about finding a place of my own? The young man swallows. He's not sure he can take any more bad news today. Yeah, he says. I know. Well, I wanted to say that before we even hear what the ruling is, I would really like it if you came with me, no matter what happens. The young man feels warm inside. The fact that she's thinking like that, that she wants him to come with her on whatever adventure or new place it is that she's looking for. I'm really honored, he says, but I'll have to think about it. Helen swallows a bit and stutters. Yeah, I understand that. Of course, with everything going on, it's not an easy decision. The young man hugs her and gives her a kiss and says, we'll talk more when we know what's happened, okay? She smiles and nods. Let's go inside. It's way too wet out here. It's a clear and cold winter's morning on BallinCraig. It's the day of judgment. A young man carries out his morning duties just to keep his mind occupied. But really, all along, his mind is racing What will be the outcome of this court case? What will become of his uncle's legacy? This wonderful little farm here? And what about the future? What about what Helen was talking about? In what feels like a looping day, a kind of groundhog day, Trevor comes up and finds the young man standing, staring longingly out over the landscape.
Hey lad, how are you holding up?
Ah, you know, Trevor. I have a lot on my mind, but I guess today at least, we're finally gonna find out what it is that's gonna happen.
That we are, laddie. That we are. I didn't understand much of what went on yesterday, but I feel like you got yourself a good guy there. I mean, Henry and Thomas's recommendation I take for a lot, and I think he did a good job, don't you?
Yeah, I think so, says the young man, but it's almost like they're speaking a different language. The kind of questions that they were asking me just didn't seem to really have anything to do with what I thought was important.
Oh, I know, laddie. That's all the legalese stuff for you. Anyway, I better go get changed. And you should too. We gotta get going.
So Trevor heads off to climb back into his slightly dated and ill-fitting suit. And once again, the day after, they set off from BallinCraig Estate. But this time, it is to get that final decision in court. And if they were quiet yesterday as they were heading off and driving towards the city, today they seem even quieter. I think both their minds are racing about what it is that will happen soon. The young man and Trevor did not make it back to BallinCraig Estate that night. That's because they got some good news. The judge upheld their side of the case. The replacements on the farm were fully adequate, and as far as he was concerned, barring any final last day disasters, the young man has met all the stipulations on the will. In fact, the judge was quite scathing of the way that the other solicitors had been handling the whole affair, and said that he thought the fact that somebody related and with a local area interest had been taking care of it, and the connections with the councillor was so outrageous that it was borderline fraud. So both the young man and Trevor ended up staying in a hotel because they went up and celebrated with a great big slap-up meal at a nice restaurant the following day, even though the young man paid the solicitor's fee of £7,000, he's in the clear. It's a matter of days and BallinCraig is his. So they had to come back though, because, you know, somebody needs to milk the cows and everything like that. They couldn't, so they left very early this morning, even though they had a pleasant enough stay in a hotel. So they're both just in getting changed now, and the solicitor is actually coming over. I think they've largely given up, so they're coming up this afternoon to sign the final paperwork and hand the deeds to the young man. Back in his normal clothes, the young man checks up. Yeah, okay, there's a bit of cleaning to do, but it's actually not too bad. I mean, he got it all done in the morning before they left for court, so it's not like the cows has been unattended for an awful long time. But with the grass off the fields now, it is time to start using some of the hay bales here to feed both the cows and the sheep. So the young man is starting to dig into the supplies, but there is still plenty around on the farm, and there's even more in storage up the back. Trevor is coming back around to the house. He's probably going to grab himself a cup of tea and come lend him a hand. He doesn't have work today. So here we are, a year on, pretty much, from when the young man arrived, largely clueless, completely unprepared, somewhat reluctant, and now we have somebody who is at least a very capable farmer in the making, and with a renewed passion and desire to make farming work for him. But as he is working on clearing up the cows, there are still thoughts on his mind. When Helen came to speak to him the other night and mentioned that she's now actually sold her flat and like her art commissions is completed and everything like that, and she is now genuinely going to start looking for a property where she can keep her sheep and have an art studio and all that kind of stuff, it has put a bit of a dampener on his celebration of being able to keep BallinCraig Estate here, because it's not going to feel the same without her. Young man is just offloading some more silage when Trevor waves at him, kills the engine and comes over. What's up, Trevor? How are you doing? Oh, I'm doing fine, laddie. But listen, there's a certain young lady over the front door, and I don't know. She looks both happy and serious, and I sense you guys probably need to have a bit of a chat. So why don't I finish off this bit here and you can head over. The young man swallows and nods. Okay, Trevor. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. And it's with quite heavy steps that the young man walks around, uncertainty swirling around in his head.
Hi,
he says to Helen.
Hi yourself, says Helen. Listen, we need to talk.
Yeah, says the young man. Come inside. So the morning passes. The young man and Helen are in the house. Trevor is finishing up the last of the animal duties for the day. It's a fairly nice day, but there's obviously intense discussions going on, and it isn't until after lunch when the solicitor comes visiting the farm again that they all emerge. The solicitor emerges from the car. His face looks a bit like curdled milk. He is quite clearly not pleased about the outcome of the court decision. The young man steps forward.
Oh, I guess you must be rather pleased with yourself,
snorts the solicitor. Not really, says the young man. I would have wished that
I could have just come here, done the work in a fair and even way, and that you would have been the caretaker of my uncle's will that he entrusted to you.
Well, very well. You have the court's decision. The farm will be yours,
snorts the solicitor. Trevor looks over at Helen and the young man and then towards the solicitor.
Actually, I do believe there was an additional clause. The young man had a letter mentioning that no matter what he chose, there would be some money as well.
Well, yes, you're absolutely right, Trevor. Since the whole thing is now up in the air and all done, I guess it doesn't matter anymore. But you will be delighted to know that your uncle also bequeathed you £200,000.
What? Says you. 200? But how? Where did he get all that money from?
Trevor grins. The old guy was pretty tight-fisted most of the time.
The young man takes a sort of staggering step, turns away from the solicitor to look at Helen and Trevor.
Guys, this... I don't know what to say.
Helen smiles at the young man.
This is really good, she says. It means you can do whatever you want with the farm.
Well, about that, says the young man and turns back towards the solicitor.
You know what?
What?
Says the solicitor. Now that I have the deeds, you might be pleased to know that I've actually decided that I'm going to sell BallinCraig Estate.
Trevor. What?
Helen steps in. No, you, what are you doing? She says, you can't be doing this.
The solicitor simply gives a wry little smile.
Well, I do believe that my father's offer may still be at hand. You could, quite comfortably add a substantial amount of money to the 200,000, give you a completely clean slate somewhere else.
Lad, you can't do this, shouts Sheva.
Trevor, the young man, takes hold of the deeds from the solicitor.
Well, my decision is pretty final. I am going to sell. I'm going to sell BallinCraig Estate to the only person that I would actually ever really trust to run this place properly.
At this point, the solicitor's face folds a bit. This doesn't sound like his dad, the counselor. The young man turns.
I'm going to sell BallinCraig Estate to Trevor for £1.
Lad, but no, my uncle, your uncle, he lad, what are you talking about? This was your uncle's will. You should have the farm.
My uncle made it quite clear in the letter that what he really wanted for me was to experience farming again and get that sense of freedom and the ability to work with the land, and he was quite clear that he would support me no matter what I chose. And Trevor, I can't think of anybody who deserves this farm more than you. I have something else that I want to do, he says and turns towards Helen. That is, if she'll still have me coming along on her adventure. Helen can't help but smile.
Are you serious? She says. Oh, I don't actually think I've been any more serious about anything in my life, says the young man.
The solicitor snorts.
Well, it sounds like you've got it all sewn up. I don't think there's any further need for me here.
And he stumps off to his car. The young man turns back to Helen.
So what do you say? Are you ready for a new chapter? Very much so, says Helen.
Trevor doesn't sort of really want to cut in on the romantic moment, but he's like, look, laddie, I don't know what to say. The young man turns to Trevor and grins. Well, Trevor, that makes a difference.
No, I want this for you.
But this whole farm, you can't just sell it for a pound. I should try and get a mortgage for it or something.
Trevor, you're buying it, and you're buying it for a pound.
Look, I'll come on back and help if you need it at some points, and, you know, if we're not too busy on maybe our new farm, he says and smiles at Helen.
Oh, says Trevor. Well, I think I'm gonna go look at this paperwork, and I think I'm gonna leave you two alone for a moment, he says and backs off gently.
They don't seem to notice at all.
And so the solicitor drives off BallinCraig Estate, very unsatisfied, and for the last time. And so with a young man and a young woman who are very much in love and are ready to set out on a new adventure, this is indeed the end of the young man's adventures on BallinCraig Estate. And so, with a last few shots out over the farm that we've come to know so well, through more than 20 episodes now, we've reached the end of this series. So this was the very first roleplay series that I've ever done here on Overcourt Gaming. But I very much enjoyed creating a story, although it was in FS17, because 19 wasn't really quite ready at the time when we started this. It has been really, really fun to try and put a story together, and it's not going to stop here. Although this series is finished, it is indeed, in many ways, the beginning of a new. So what's going to happen is that shortly another video is going to come up here on Overcourt Gaming. I have been researching a few maps and a few different storylines, and I still haven't settled on just one version. So what's going to come out in a little while is a series of three pilot videos, all in one release on YouTube. It's going to be three little tasters of three possible stories here on Overcourt Gaming. Only one of them will go ahead. Two of the pilots will feature the young man and Helen here as the young couple, as they set out on two potentially different new adventures. And there's going to be a third pilot for something quite different. So if you have enjoyed the young man's adventures, keep an eye out on the channel. Basically, my intention is to release the pilot episodes very, very close together with this final episode of the young man on BallinCraig Estate. So thank you to all of those who have watched throughout the whole thing. I hope you have enjoyed it. I hope that moving into 19, we can create a new story that is going to be even more exciting and hopefully also entertaining. But for now, thank you very much for watching from Overcourt Gaming, and see you again soon.